Oh, hello, this is Data Driven Formula One, and I'm Ganna and Pogrebna, and Patrick Henz is with me today. And we are going
Hello.
to talk about, hi Patrick, we're going to talk about Juan Manuel Fangio and yeah, his career, his legacy, and you know, what he means to the Formula One sport. Again, I will do the intros. So I'm a professor of business analytics and data science, and I wrote several papers on Formula One. I'm a behavioral scientist, so I'm approaching this as a kind of amateur in engineering, but sort of a person who knows a lot about behavior. And Patrick wrote multiple books on Formula One. So he wrote, I mean, one of my favorite books on Enzo Ferrari, written by Patrick, and compliance as a Formula One car. So that's another really cool book that Patrick wrote. And yeah, so we are just talking about something that we're really passionate about, and that's Formula One. And today we're going to discuss Fangio.
Yeah, thank you, Ganna. And what we both like is not only to retell the story of Formula One, but also somehow align this to today's to us, to management, to science, whatever. And with this,
yeah.
I think the data-driven Formula One channel is a little bit different than other channels or other podcasts who also speak about Formula One.
Yeah, and we're interested in insight, like what insight can we derive from data and how data can help you differentiate yourself from others. And, you know, we use Formula One history to be able to tell the story about how data changed throughout the history. So today we're talking about Juan Manuel Fangio, who was, yeah, born in 1911 and died... Well, relatively recently, I have to say, 1995, it was a long life.
Yeah.
So last time I talked about Nino Farina, who died in a car, and he was very young when he died. But, you know, Fangio lived a long life and was, he was five-time champion, world champion, right? If I'm not mistaken. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Fangio, and maybe you want to come back to this later, for some, also based on data, on studies, is the best Formula One driver ever.
I want to question that paper, actually. I think we need a separate episode. Yeah. So Patrick refers to a paper that was written by people from, so one of the co-authors is definitely from University of Sheffield, and there are some other people on that paper. So there is a paper trying to establish who is the best driver of all time. And that paper argued that Juan Manuel Fangio is the best driver of all time. But I think we will do a separate episode discussing that paper because really it depends on your assumption of what the best driver means, what it means
yes.
to be the best driver. So, well, we will talk about Fangio as a great man and a great driver, but yeah, I have to say here that I'm not that convinced that the results of that paper are valid. I think this is something that we can discuss in a separate episode.
Exactly, and I'm sure we will discuss. I mean, in general, I have your opinion as, I mean, from my point of view, it's impossible to compare a Formula One driver in 1950 to somebody in 2020, as even if it's still called Formula One. I mean, today's car, there's nearly nothing to do with the 1950 Formula One car. And the races have been also different. So, but anyway, I think it will be a great discussion. So you see here a brief profile. He was born 1911.
Yeah, and we have to say, yeah, he was born in a family of Italian immigrants. So his grandfather came from Italy. And I bought some land, I think, in Argentina. And yeah, there were six children in that family, and he was the fourth child. So it was not like he had a big, I mean, he was not like poor guy, you know, they had some property, but definitely it was a very challenging environment. Another thing that was quite striking about his childhood is that at the age of 13, he quit school and decided to become a mechanic. And from the age of 16, he was basically going door to door fixing people's cars, and he got quite sick. He actually had he caught some illness. I don't know how accurate the diagnosis were at the time, but he had some sort of very bad chest infection, and he was basically bedridden for a very long time. And his mother was his main carer. And I think that was the reason why when he finally his health became slightly better, his parents let him do whatever he wanted. You can take the garage, right, and do whatever you want. But then he was also in the army, right? He was enlisted in the army, and that's where his talent, in a sense, his driving talent was discovered, because he was driving an officer, as far as I understand, and then he started competing. So he finally felt that he could actually, you know, compete. And so that was an absolutely amazing journey into driving, because, you know, at one point, like I said, he was definitely someone who was very interested in cars, but you know, it's not like he was from 4 years of age, 3 years of age, like Lewis Hamilton was, you know, participating in races or something. He was just someone who was interested in cars, and then, you know, almost, you know, we can say almost died because, you know, he was ill as a kid, and then, you know, he had support from his parents to do what he wanted, mm-hmm. to pursue his passion. Yep. And then, yeah, so he drove for many different teams. Go ahead.
I just wanted to add a little bit. As you've mentioned, his family originally came from Italy. So they immigrated to Argentina, which is not that uncommon, as a high part of Argentinians. Their ancestors came from Italy. For example, if you have the luck to go there, you may recognize that the Spanish spoken in Argentine has like a slight Italian accent. Similar to Farina, about whom we spoke last time, he also was, in general, he liked sports. So he had been also quite good in playing football, soccer, yeah, as you call it in the US. And that's why he also got one of his two nicknames, El Treco, which means the bow-legged or bendy-legged one, in the way as he was able to dribble with the ball. The other nickname, El Maestro, is a little bit more related to, of course, to his driving style, as he was able to be successful with nearly whatever car. He's the only one up to today who had been able to win championships with four different brands: Alfa Romeo, Ferrari, Mercedes-Benz, and Maserati.
His overall championship record was beaten by Michael Schumacher.
Yes. Right?
I don't know,
yes,
maybe someone else by now, but yeah, definitely. Yes. Michael exactly. comes to mind as well.
Yes, but Michael only won with two different brands, yeah, with Benetton and Ferrari. So
true,
this is
true.
The outstanding here from Fangio is that he was able to do this with four different brands.
Yeah. But I think, you know, like you said, Patrick, I mean, back in the day, it was completely different. I mean, the meaning of the team was completely different, right?
It exactly.
was a handful of people, and probably the driver was the main guy, you know, making the majority of decisions. So
exactly.
you know, yeah.
Exactly. But let's say interesting is, so even if he has, let's say, a more Italian background, he wasn't feeling that attached to the team. So he joined teams. He left teams where he saw it is best for him. So he not felt somehow attached to the teams that you stay there for a longer time. So this was, I think, quite interesting.
Yeah, I think he strikes me as a very, very independent guy.
Yes, exactly.
And, very independent decision maker. We also, to add to his character, was that he never married. He had a girlfriend for many years,
yeah.
But he never married. And I think that's also kind of shows the, that it's kind of, he's his own man.
Exactly.
Making his own decisions. That kind of relative or absolute independence from everything, I think, sometimes helped and sometimes backfired, but yeah, that was his way. That was his way of doing things. And even when he retired, he bought a Mercedes dealership, and then he became the head of Mercedes in Argentina. So he was, quite an important guy for Mercedes in that region. So in a sense, he was, even when he retired, he was very much connected with cars.
Exactly.
And I also feel like, sometimes we will see that with some drivers that, kind of stuck around probably for a little bit too long in the sport. You can't really say that about Fangio. I think he exited at exactly the right moment.
Yeah.
And then just was returning sometimes for some showcase driving. And, it was a very, very interesting career. Definitely very thought through strategy of how he did things. And there were some adventures as well that we're going to talk about soon. But yeah, he won, like you see on the slide. He had 24 wins and in the world championship, and yeah, he won. I thought he won five competitions, right? If I'm not mistaken, yeah.
Yes, we will see this.
Yeah, and so he won with Alfa Romeo and Maserati, I believe, right? It was Maserati.
Yes.
So
yes, we will show this.
We have a separate slide. Sorry, you have
exactly.
to forgive me. I don't remember all the teams, but definitely. Yeah, so we do have Alfa Romeo, Ferrari, Maserati, and Mercedes. Yeah, that's what we have on the screen. And like I said, Mercedes was his kind of continued. He continued his journey with Mercedes after he retired.
Exactly. And but also, as you said, he stayed quite independent, because I don't know from which year, but also he did some TV commercials for Alfa Romeo later. So he always stays quite independent.
Yeah, exactly. And we will show the kind of his later photos. I think he was paid $20,000 to qualify for a race in later, like one of the later years. So we'll come back to that.
Yeah. And with this, we come to a different chapter. And I think something we like to do in this podcast to speak not only to show you the normal dates, number of wins, but also maybe present some interesting chapters which you conclude or may also conclude to his character or how he was in person. And one interesting chapter from my point of view is his experience with the Cuban Grand Prix. Mm-hmm. The Cuban Grand Prix, we are not speaking about Formula One, but sports cars. And as mentioned in the last episode, at this time in 1950s, drivers not drove exclusively sports cars or exclusively Formula One, but they switched and
so
they've been more universal.
Yeah, also, we need to mention that he basically drove at Le Mans, And there is so we talked about when we talked about 1951 season, we showed you Simca Gortini car. It was kind of same color, but almost completely different car for Le Mans to survive the 24 hours. And he drove, you know, he participated in 1950 competition in Le Mans. And so he was, he basically drove not only, the point is like he drove in a lot of other out of season events. He drove at Le Mans and not in one season, but in multiple seasons. And he was also in Formula One. So he was really very enthusiastic about his driving and his
competition. Exactly. I mean, he was a real racer, you may conclude.
Yeah, exactly.
So we are in 1957 and Fangio, together with a lot of other drivers, had been invited to participate in the Grand Prix of Cuba. And something similar, which we mentioned in the last episode, also here, the actual dictator Fulgencio Batista wanted to present the power of his country with technology and with such competitive events. So that's why he also tried to invite famous drivers to have such an race car events, including the world's most fastest cars at that moment, including Ferrari, Maserati, and others.
American and cars, so Americans yes. Definitely were, so it was quite different from Fidel Castro's regime. Yes. So, and the Americans actually, you know, could go at the time. So that was prior to 1960. And the whole kind of crisis that we saw then. And so at that time it was still possible to see American tourists in Cuba.
Yeah. And of course it was also meant to get tourists to the country.
Exactly.
And it was for the drivers, it was of course very impressive of the setting. For example, Stirling Moss said, racing along the waterfront of the Malecón in the vibrant city of Havana was a remarkable experience. I mean, as we have seen maybe photos and videos of Cuba or have been there ourselves, we may imagine the atmosphere of such a race in this setting. 1957, the race at the end was won by Juan Manuel Fangio. At that time, he was driving a Maserati 300S. And on the second position, second and third, we had two Ferraris. The first one by Carroll Shelby, and maybe a name you may be familiar with. Carroll Shelby, the creator of the famous Cobra. In fact, he had been first driving for Ferrari, but due to differences with Enzo Ferrari, different opinions, he split from the company and decided first to design the Cobra and then support Ford in the efforts to win the 24 hours of Le Mans.
Le Mans, yeah, and there is now a recent film with Matt Damon, where you know this epic Le Mans competition is portrayed, and how you know Shelby was kind of instrumental to
exactly. So he also became a very famous person in motorsports.
Yeah, because you know that was the time when Ford decided to beat Ferrari in Le Mans. And, but that's a different story. Today we're going to concentrate on Fangio.
It's a different story. And anyway, so the 57 race was quite successful. So the regime decided to have it again the next year, 1958. But here we had some tragic events, especially for Fangio, but also for Fangio as he was kidnapped. He was kidnapped by rebels who have been already near to, let's say, to the new revolutionary circles. And the idea was to sabotage the race with the idea that the government would cancel the race, which would be bad for all the tourism, would show that the country is politically unstable again, with this to show to the other countries and to avoid that more tourists would like to visit Cuba, so to weaken the actual regime.
Yeah, so this were Fidel Castro supporters, yes. Yeah, you know, and yeah, so
maybe not directly him, but let's say they have been left wing.
Exactly, the kind of the revolutionary
exactly
rebels, yeah.
Yeah, but unfortunately for them, I mean, the plan didn't work out, so.
It didn't work out in the sense that the race wasn't canceled. The race still went ahead. However, Batista still looked a little bit stupid as a result because, the law enforcement couldn't do much about the fact that the front runner and probably the most probable winner of the race was actually captured by the kidnappers. And in that sense, that wasn't very, that's still kind of partially, it didn't have a massive impact, but it partially did succeed in signaling the instability in the region.
Exactly. So as you said, Batista looked quite helpless as he couldn't do anything, let's say, to protect this star drivers. But nevertheless, Batista decided that the race has to go on, and it went on just without a Fangio. But unfortunately, maybe even more tragic, well, quite surely more tragic, there was a fatal accident as the local driver, Armando Garcia Cifuentes, lost control over his Ferrari at a curve, ironically near the US embassy, and the car crashed into a group of people. We had seven people died and about 40 had been injured. So the Grand Prix had been stopped and Moss was declared as the winner as he was leading the race at that moment.
Yeah, I think it's also important to explain that the race actually happened within the city and it wasn't quite... Yes. It's not like there was a track, so it's quite a different way of driving because when you have a track, it's kind of you get used to it and you have an opportunity to race in advance. I mean, this was literally in the middle of Havana, so you couldn't actually train much there on that road. So you're basically racing in the middle of the city. And even though, for the time it was not that unusual, I mean, those conditions were not conditions where you could do much and mistakes like this happened. And so, yeah, you can see these are the photos from the actual event. We've already talked last time when we talked about Nina Farina, when Nina Farina crashed into a crowd in Argentina. But I mean, this was another example where, the audience was too close to the track, quote unquote track, but it was actually just a road. And you can see there in the photo that there are just some basically sandbags along the track. So there's not much protection at all. Like if you drive off the road, then you can't stop and you would be crashing into people. There is nothing.
Exactly. But let's say this was nothing special to Cuba. This was how the driving was, especially in Europe. We had the Mille Miglia, we had the Targa Florio, we had the street races around Mugello. So it was quite the way, which was quite common.
Yeah, it was common. Yeah, exactly. But I mean, what I was trying to say is that on a usual track, like you had some way of training, like you could go and train. on the track, but I mean, in the city, like, you can't really do that. So the probability is a lot higher if you can't train, obviously, and then to have an accident. And this was, unfortunately, you know,
exactly. And that's why fatal. And that's why also these races died out in Europe, as there have been, unfortunately, each year many deadly accidents. Not only drivers died, but also they crashed into groups. Also because the people, they really stand directly beside the streets, as you maybe still saw in the 1980s in the Rally Championships. Mm-hmm. They tried to get their photo and just jumped back in the last seconds. Also, the people themselves, they brought themselves into danger. And at the end, all of these races had been canceled.
At one point, when I looked at the data on fatalities, actually throughout the history of Formula One, we had about 50 fatalities that with drivers, I mean, you know, that happened either in qualifying or at the actual races. So it's not that bad if you think about the speeds at which, you know, these guys operate. But clearly some of the regulations that we have at the moment, they're there to protect the drivers. And obviously, you know, the tracks are designed in ways in which, you know, it's difficult to injure people. But even then, you know, from every once in a while, we do have, injuries and, you know, quite a dangerous situations for the drivers. But back in the day, it was, I'm actually surprised that there just, you know, 50 people we're talking about, you know, like when we look at the whole the whole kind of percentage of risk that people were taking every time they would be driving these cars.
Yeah, I completely agreed.
Mm-hmm. So we have to say that it all kind of had a, despite this fatality for Fangio, it was an adventure, right? It was
exactly, and this is interesting. As later, the word adventure comes also back in one of his famous quotes. So let's say he seemed to have a good, relatively good relation with the kidnappers, so he didn't felt an additional threat for himself, for his health or life. So really he perceived it as an adventure.
So they treat him quite well, even though he was captured. So it was, he was told on the outset that they're just going to hold him until the end of the race. Yep. And that's exactly what happened. He was released after the race. So they kept the promise. Yep. And yeah, but the legacy of Havana Championship kind of ended very soon.
I mean, it continued even a little bit after the new regime took over, but they changed the location to not have it in this important part, the capital, but somewhere near an airport. So there was the last race in 1960. And again, it was Sterling Moss who won in a Maserati. And also the competitors still had been the other famous car makers as Ferrari, but this was really the last one. And quite interesting, it happened after the new regime was already in place. So it was not that we had the revolution and everything became forbidden, but it was also a kind of process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And I guess it just became very difficult for the competitors to get to Havana afterwards. So it was a combination of reasons. And of course, I think maybe also partly, you know, Formula One is such an elitist sport that was probably didn't quite measure up to the aspirations of the of the people in power in Cuba after 1960, that such a kind of posh event would take place in Havana. Maybe there were, like, obviously it was not the only reason, but yeah, it was kind of combination of reasons there. And, you know, yeah, the difficulty of getting there with US, not, you know, you're not able to fly from the US, which means that you're flying quite far away. Or, you know, taking a boat, which is even worse. So it's, you know, it's, yeah, it's just the complexity
of it. Today it's even worse. I mean, you're not, of course, you're not allowed to fly from the US, but also based on the restrictions.
I thought it eased a little bit now. Isn't that true? I'm not aware of the current.
But they took it, they eased back. So let's say if, I am Maserati, and I'm not allowed to do business in Cuba. If not, I would be blacklisted inside the US. And as for Maserati, as for all others, the important market is the US and not Cuba. Of course, nobody would try to bypass such regulations.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So it's kind of a combination of business and politics that we are looking at here. But the important point here, again, just to understand the character of Fangio, you know, I think it probably isn't a pleasant event, even if, you know, you've been treated well or whatnot, but, you know, I don't think every person would describe that as an adventure, but, I mean, this guy did. And certainly, you know, that also shows the character that, you know, he understood why. He was obviously explained why that this happened, and, you know, he... took it, he basically, I'm not gonna say he took it lightly, but he basically, you know, he basically didn't make a big fuss out of it, that, you know, I'm a star and, you know, this happened. So he even in some interviews was saying that if it was done for a good cause, for, you know, for the people of Cuba, then he would support this type of stuff. So, you know, he was quite a he was a very strong person in that sense. So
yes, and I mean, also, I mean, as being Argentinian, I mean, you've been let's say used to revolutions in South America at that time. I mean, he himself was supported by the left-wing government in Argentina, by Perón y Evita. So theoretically, he wasn't, I mean, of course, they're not that left as the communist Cuba, but let's say he was used to left governments and have been supported by such. Mm-hmm. So this may be another reason why the kidnappers treated him quite good.
Yeah,
but this is, let's say, a theory.
Yeah, exactly. But still, a very strange choice of a person for the kidnapping. You know, especially considering the kind of all the relationships with, you know, with Argentinian government. But, you know, okay, well, they made that decision, and that's what happened. And, you know, like I'm saying, like I just think that not everybody would come out from this experience and say, oh, actually, you know, it was it was an easy walk for me. You know, that I think you need to have some presence of character to do that.
Exactly, I completely agree.
Yeah, in terms of technology, yeah, very interesting set of cars there. And, you know, we are only showing you the Formula One, or, you know, yeah, even like 1949, this is Ferrari, obviously, but you know, that's kind of prior to championships.
Exactly. And I mean, so also as he started being a career as a mechanic, so he was not the gentleman driver, and also he had to build, he had to go to the smaller series. So he started, as you would do also today, in a Formula 2 car before he had been able to drive in Formula 1. So quite a classic way to arrive in the series.
Yeah, exactly. And like we said before, he was driving in other events. Definitely there is a whole range of in terms of technology, there is a whole range right there. And notice, like after Alfa Romeo, he was driving Maserati, and even in, you know, he came back to Maserati after going to Mercedes and Ferrari. So that again just shows that he was basically, like Patrick said before, he was taking the opportunities within mm-hmm. the teams, but also he was taking the opportunities with engineering. I think each one of these teams had something interesting going on in terms of, new piece of idea in terms of engineering. And that kind of also shows that he tried to vary, what he can do in terms of, speeding the car up. Whichever team provided more potential in his view was on top of his radar, right?
Yes.
And I also can imagine that with with Ferrari in particular, it might have been quite difficult decision for him to go to Ferrari in 1956, because that's kind of two very strong characters.
Yes, the hands of Ferrari. Maybe this was the reason why it was just 1 year.
Yeah, but I feel also that he just tried different things, and like I said, he was riding Gardini on other occasions, and then he was driving Mercedes after he retired, and was quite an active promoter of Mercedes trademark in Argentina afterwards. So yeah, I just think that it was his way to try different things and different teams.
Yeah, and one important point, and it's the reason why 52, you see it in gray, he won the 51 championship with Alfa Romeo, but as Alfa left the championship in 51, he was the champion, but without a contract, so he hadn't been able to drive the 51 championship. So he took the opportunity, which have been especially offered by Maserati, to drive for them for some non-championship races. Thanks to this, he got into contact with Maserati, and they offered him a seat for the 53 season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and of course, and we see the BRM there already as well. So that's another very interesting team that we're gonna discuss when we get to 1952 season and going forward in 1950s. The cool thing, yeah, I guess he was not afraid to try different things,
exactly.
And took it as an opportunity. Rather than a challenge, and I think he was, I think, again in comparison with Nino Farina. Nino Farina, I haven't met the guy obviously, but I imagine that he was quite a crazy person in terms of wanting to win. Fangio, I imagine that he was quite a weighted guy in that sense. I mean, obviously he liked the speed and he liked the cars, but it was constantly the kind of rational, the dominant rational part in him when he was considering what team to pick and how I want to do strategically, what is my strategic positioning this season and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah.
I agree. And I mean, with this, we are already deep in the discussions about the behavior. And,
That is quite, we covered, I think, most of the list there. Yeah, again, I think I'd say that he was quite a calculating person in that sense. So he was, I feel that he was not just, not it was not a, never a win at all costs. I think it was very weighted, risk against the opportunity each time. And definitely, I think his understanding of mechanical engineering always helped as well, because like I said before, when we discussed in 1951 season, be it a decision about tires, be it a decision about the general race strategy, it was always very very weighted, despite the fact that he had a very strong character and definitely
exactly. And I guess resuming all this, this is the reason why they called him the maestro, the master.
Yeah, exactly. And like we said before, there is even a paper saying that he's the greatest driver. But I mean, we're going to question that a little bit later. But this is his picture from kind of later years.
Exactly. And, I mean, as he was such a famous champion, you can find a number of quotes from him. Mm-hmm. So I put here some of them, which I find interesting and shows his character. For the first, the races are not won in the first curve, but many times lost there. And this is what we discussed. He was a calculating person, so he was maybe not that emotional driven, but what it is important to really win the race, and which means that maybe you have to give in the first curve, let your competitor pass, but ensure that you stay on the track and stay inside the race. So he really was thinking on the long term.
Yeah, he reminds me a lot of Niki Lauda, and yes. Like if I had a, like if you, obviously Niki Lauda is someone we could see a lot, yes, in commenting sport. And so when I think of Nino Farina, I think, he probably was quite close to Niki Lauda in kind of character, where, yes, you would be very determined, but at the same time you always think, okay, so this is the opportunity and this is the risk, and so how do I balance these two things to kind of get my best shot?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Then the next, and I think this is somehow related to his background as a mechanic, which gave him a good insight. So he was, as a driver, very empathic into the machine, so he had a holistic idea how the car works, and also what his role as a driver is to make the car work, which we see maybe on another quote. So here you see, I learned to approach racing like a game of billiard. If you bash the ball too hard, you get to nowhere. As you handle the cue properly, you will drive more finesse. So I think this understanding meant for him that, in opposite to other drivers which permanently went to the limit, he tried maybe to stay a little bit under the limit, because also at that time the cars have been not that reliable. And as I said, this next maybe shows the same idea a little bit more on point. The driver of a racing car is a component. When I first begin, I used to grip the steering wheel firmly, and I changed gear so hard that I damaged my hand. So he understands really, as a mechanic, how the car works holistically, and he understood that while he takes the seat inside the car, that he becomes a part of this machine-human combination. Mm-hmm. So he had an understanding, a feeling, what he has to do to make this whole package human plus machine efficiently working.
Exactly. And how this whole collaboration works. So it's a collaborative effort. So yeah, it's a little bit. You know, I have this friend who's piano player, and he says always that you know the piano is like a. It's an organism. And some make it sing and some make it just make a noise. And yeah, so that's where the maestro probably also comes from, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then, you see also what he also said, never think of your car as a cold machine, but as a hot-blooded horse. So this sounds something a little bit more typical Italian. Maybe his heritage. So again, it shows as a mechanic, he understood the car and he felt somehow empathic to the machine. And we also see this today, not only race drivers, but a lot of other people, they somehow personalize their cars or other machines or even give their cars a name. A point which, of course, we not only discuss with cars, but something which gets also relevant if we speak about robotics, artificial intelligence, as we may be tempted to see an algorithm, something like a living being.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then we have the typical motivational quote, you must always strive to be the best, but you never must believe that you are.
The best. And,
yeah. So something which you can include in all motivational management courses.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, because then you stop developing. Yeah, so that's important. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the last one on this page is something I think also others said, like Michael Schumacher, driving fast on the track does not scare me. What scares me is when I drive on the highway, I get passed by some idiot who thinks he's Fangio.
Yeah.
I mean, yes, it's somehow understandable because when you're on the racetrack, of course, it should be more dangerous than on the normal streets. But the good thing is, you know that all the other 12 other pilots, they are professionals. They had a lot of experience to drive at the limit, and this may have. Make you feel a little bit more safer than it is, the situation.
Yeah, and again, it's also about the fact that we consider Formula One as a highly risky thing, but for a Formula One driver, this is a job, and that's completely yes. Not how they see it. And they could be quite risk averse, when they're driving the car. It's just all about the training and experience. So they do not see it as a risky activity. They see it as something else. And I think in the daily scenarios, this kind of extreme risk taking is just it just mimics the drivers, the racing driver behavior. Whereas actual racing driver behavior is completely the opposite of, I'm going to go and be the first at all costs. So that's completely different thinking in there. And that's what this quote
is. Yes, and maybe also this, you can compare him again to Niki Lauda. I assume you saw the movie Rush.
Mm. Yeah, I did.
I mean, there was also one of the scenes where he was driving with some of his fans, with his girlfriend, who asked him to drive like a racing driver, and he first refused because he said, I'm not driving in a race, why should I drive fast? Or something like this.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
quite similar exactly. What Fangio said here.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, and this is this is him in 1986, I think, in Nürburgring. Let me just confirm. Yeah, this is 1986 in Nürburgring, when he was just doing this like showcase drive. But yeah, also so he actually was paid, I just remembered, in 1958 he was paid $20,000 to qualify in Indianapolis. Mm-hmm. With Curtis Offenhauser car that we saw when we showed 1950 yeah. season, we demonstrated some of the, we had like a picture of the Offenhauser cars. And I mean, he didn't qualify at that point, but he was willing to try. He was willing to get in the car yeah. and try to do it. So yeah, and that's kind of also showcasing his character. But this is him in 1986 driving, as you can see, Mercedes in Nürburgring.
Yeah. And interesting his quote here. In my day, it was 75% car and mechanic, 20% driver and luck. Today, it's 95% the car. So. An interesting idea, and I mean, it would be confirmed with the fact that he won his championship with four different cars. So this may confirm this quote, as it, at that time, as we also discussed, the teams have been much smaller. So it was really still that the driver had a higher influence on the success of the team, and it was. And more important role than maybe today.
Yeah, and also we will talk about, as the kind of we go through the history of Formula One, that the cars changed and the regulation changed around the car. So at one point it was the cars were so wide that you couldn't actually bypass someone if they were faster. At least you can do that very easily, that's for sure. So this kind of the very precise specialization of people in teams took over eventually. So now it's definitely a teamwork, whereas at the time it was probably more of a driver leading the way for everyone else to make contributions to better car.
I would agree, even if even in that time, of course, it was also important to get the best engineers, especially for the engine. Maybe we'll speak a little bit more in the 1960s, but I completely agree. The driver was much more important than today, at least in the race. Of course, it's still today very important, as the best drivers attract also the best team members, and they can motivate, keep people together. But I think in the past it was still more relevant. Mm-hmm. And the last one, and with this, UK may also rely to Cuba. There are those who keep out of mischief, and there are the adventurers. We racing drivers are adventurers. The more difficult something is, the greater the attraction that comes from it. So here he used again the word adventure, and I mean, this is, I think, if we resume his legacy, this is something what we can say, that he was an adventurer. He enjoyed especially his independence, going from one team to another team. As you said, he never became married, so it seems somehow that if we want to find some words to describe him besides being the El Maestro, also it would be the adventurer or something like this.
Yeah, to me, I don't have a very poetic way of describing Fangio. I would say that he was error minimizer and precision maximizer when I think about him. So it's all basically, how do you minimize the error on a track? How do you maximize precision on a track?
So it's interesting. So he had two different sides. So he was like a professor, the master. But somehow he was also the adventurer with an importance of his personal independence, not afraid to leave his personal comfort zone, and various time check the team, not getting afraid of getting kidnapped. So he had these two different sides inside him.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. So that kind of what we think his legacy was. Of course, if you guys are watching this and you have some ideas of what you want how you would describe Fangio in one line, do let us know. You can leave some comments below the video. We'd be very interested in hearing your opinion. And generally, this probably something that we should emphasize in all these videos, is this is something that we think, and this is our opinions, but we're not thinking about those as kind of truth, the ultimate truth. So if you disagree with us and you have something to add, please do leave the comments, and we definitely would be very interested in your view on all of this.
Exactly. So to end this episode, as you already mentioned shortly, if you're curious about Juan Manuel Fangio, and if you have the opportunity to travel to Argentina, to Buenos Aires, maybe you can do a one-day trip to visit his museum, where you find also one level about his friend and competitor, Froilan Gonzalez.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is in Balcarce, so where the town where Fangio was born.
Exactly.
And yeah, we've already done our descriptions, so you can now try to do your description.
Exactly, this will be your homework.
Yeah, and leave us some comments. And on that note, we're going to end this episode. Thanks a lot, Patrick, again for...
Thanks
for your insight and into this, and thank you, thanks a lot to our viewers who were with us during this episode. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Bye bye.